Let all the glory be given unto you, everlasting Father, as we commit this moment of your word, of this exaltation within your hand. We pray that you may minister unto us, minister unto our spirit, minister unto our souls. There are some of those that are watching right now whose hearts are broken. They are so down because of circumstances, time that they are going through. But I pray that you may, oh God, strengthen them from within in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray as the word will be preached, that you may minister to somebody, that you may heal, that you may deliver, that you may set free and transform somebody's life. It is written, you sent your word, and your word healed them. Let the word of today may fulfill its purpose, its divine and intended purposes, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that you may move. Move, O Yahweh God, in this day. Move in this day, O God. Do your will among your people. Lord God, glorify your name. We exalt you and we commit this moment within your hand. Show yourself, Lord. Heal, touch, speak to us. Correct us, rebuke us whenever necessary. Set again our feet on the right path, O Lord God, that we may move into our destiny just as we have planned it before the foundation of the world. We exalt you and we bless you in Jesus' name. And all the saints of God say, Amen. Well, glory to God, honor, majesty unto the living God. If you are just joining, beloved, let me greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and welcome you to this program, Grace for Life. For the next few minutes, we would like to share the Word of God with you. And I want you to take your Bible, quickly turn it in the book of Psalm. We are just going to read one verse. Today we're just going to look at one verse, and we will be blessed by the word of God. The Lord has allowed you to tune in today. Tune in today because he has something for you. And I want you to remain put as we are reading the word of God today. It reads as follows, Psalm chapter 37, verse 25. It reads as follows. Let me rather read 25 to 26. It reads as follows. I have been young and now am old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging for bread. Let me read again. Verse 25, I have been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging for bread. He is ever lending generously and his children become a blessing. Somebody say amen to the word of God. These are the word of an aging man, David, the man that was nearing death, a man that has come to his old age in the latter part of his life. As he sit down under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he began to pin down this word for us, pin down the word, this word into the scripture of the scripture as he was guided by the Holy Spirit. And right there in verse 25, David makes an observation, and also in the same time, it's an observation at the same time, also a conclusion right there, whereby he states strongly, firmly, with all assurance, without any shadow of doubt, David looking back, and he said, I have been young, and now I'm an old man. I'm an old man, but yet, throughout my entire life, I have never, he uses a strong word right there, never N-E-V-E-R. That is a strong word. Very constant in his declaration. He said, I have never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his children begging for bread. David said, that my experience, that my observation, that's something that I've lived throughout my life. Throughout my life, since my youth until now, my old age, as I'm about to exit this world, I have noticed one thing, that God does not forsake his own. And the righteous, they are not forsaken. Not only them, David goes on to say, even your children, talking about your descendant, David say they don't get to a point whereby they become beggars, begging for bread, actually begging for food. That talks about a state of poverty. Because when you get to a point whereby you begin to beg for bread, that tells you that you do no longer have even the necessity. That is talks about, that is a language of poverty. David says, I have been young and now I am old. I am assuring you one thing. I can certify unto you one thing. I have never seen the righteous forsaken or his children begging for bread. Such a very interesting Psalm, chapter 87. We don't have time to go through the entire text, but bear with me, suffer with me, just to give you a few elements that about this Psalm. It's a Psalm all about that. It brings you about, if you take it from verse 1, it gives you about the contrast between the destiny of the wicked and the future of the righteous man. That's what David is looking at. He's trying to contrast these two, the life of wicked man and the life of the righteous. David goes on showing us into this psalm. He shows us one thing, that though the wicked may prosper today, but they will be cut short. They will be cut off on the day of the Lord. That's what you see happening in this chapter. That the life, the prosperity of today, prosperity of the wicked will be cut short on the day of the Lord. But on the contrary, the righteous will inherit the earth, and they will be vindicated by the Lord. That's what David is trying to bring unto us throughout this psalm. David is trying to reflect on this, whether the righteous or the unrighteous will enjoy the promised land. And now, throughout the psalm, you see David, as he goes down, he's trying to instruct us as righteous. Righteous, yeah, we're talking about the children of God, right there. Those who believe in God, those of us of this time, the time of grace. And when you take it from the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 17, the Bible says us that sin enter the world through one man, and also through one man, much more through one man, those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. So you see, righteousness has been given us unto us in this moment as a gift in response to the faith that we place in Christ. God has declared us righteous, not because we deserve it, but because Christ died for us, and by believing in him, God declares us righteous. So every child of God is declared a righteous, and he is now called to walk into righteousness. We receive that seal. We receive that gift that has granted us, that has acquitted us from sin, and God, because of our faith in Christ, has declared us righteous, and we are now called to walk into righteousness. So, I'm not dwelling there because that's not my message today, but David is trying, as I say, to instruct us. He's trying to instruct the righteous not to envy the seeming outward success of the wicked. We live in
the world at times, beloved, we see this contrast, even in our days, whereby at times you will see a non-Christian, somebody that is not even a born again, that does not even care about God, but you see them prospering in their ways. They go about committing crime. They go about doing all sorts of vice, evil things out there. But yet in their doing, their one thing, you see them prospering. It seems like all their move are just blessed with the success and here and there. And throughout this service, David is reflecting, he's trying to instruct us to say, brethren, do not envy the seeming outward success of the wicked, as they will just be short-lived. They will just be short-lived. So what David is trying to teach us right there, if we are not if I envy the righteous, what David is encouraging us, yes, to do, beloved, is to persevere in justice, to persevere in righteousness. Irrespective of what we see in our world, irrespective of whether the wicked are prospering in their way, in all that they do, and we seem to be like on the bad receiving end, David said, persevere in righteousness, because what the wicked are amassing today, it will be cut short on the day of the Lord. But us as righteous will inherit. The Lord. So we have there a call from David that we may persevere into righteousness. We have there a message from David to patiently wait in faith on the Lord, because the Lord is faithful. That's what David is trying to show us throughout this Psalm 37, making a call for us to persevere in righteousness, making a call unto us not to envy the weak man, but to just wait in faith on the Lord, who is faithful. Now, as you read this psalm, you find a summary when it comes to verse 25 that I've just read unto you. Verse 25 seems to be a summary of this chapter. This is where David seems to be rounding it up. This is where he seems to be, landing in his observation, as he brings about this observation unto us, because he has been talking about the wicked. He has been talking about making that contrast, comparison, if you want, between the wicked and the righteous. Then all of a sudden, as he goes about talking about that, he begins to bring in unto us the justice, the faithfulness of God. As he lands through this observation, David lands one conclusion there. He hammered it and he drives it home by saying, I was a young man and I am now old, yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken or their children begging for bread. What, beloved, a conclusion. What such a comforting word. These verses, I'm saying, it's an observation made by David, a man nearing his death, a man in the latter part of his life, and he brings unto us these words. And he say, beloved, I was young, now I am old. I have never seen the righteous abandoned or forsaken, nor his children begging for bread. This is really, beloved, a message of comfort unto us. Some of us, when we read this, we need really to find comfort in those words, knowing that the Lord in whom we have believed, the Lord in whom we have placed our trust, he is a faithful God. He's a God that does not abandon his own. He's a God that does not forsake his righteous. Not only them, but he takes also care of their descendant. I believe we are called here to find comfort, especially maybe right now where you are, considering the situation across the world, considering the uncertainties that this global pandemic has brought to the world. You have started wondering about God. You've started wondering about your life, asking so many questions, and without that left actually maybe right now without answers. And today the Lord is bringing unto you this word to remind every one of us, I am a faithful God that does not forsake his own. If you are following me, I want you to make that declaration with me. Type it there on that comment section. Type it there. I am a righteous and the Lord is not going to forsake me. My descendant will not beg for bread. That's what David is making here. And I want you, beloved, today to believe in the faithfulness of God. Irrespective of what you see happening right now around you, the word of God tells us, the word of God certifies unto us strongly, vehemently, really, that the Lord is faithful. He is faithful. The situation around the world, beloved, has not changed God. David said, I was young and now I am old. He looked back at the span of his life and he said, this God is faithful. He is a faithful God. We need to understand that whenever, beloved, we are dealing with any harshness of or adversity, we should remember always this, that God is faithful. Right now, God wants you to know that he is faithful. Let me quickly now just bring, draw some point from this David observation that says, I was young, now I am old. I have never seen the righteous abandoned or forsaken, or his generation, his descendant, begging for bread. What is David teaching us right there from this verse? What can we learn? Number one, God is faithful. Somebody say, God is faithful. Right where you are, just say, or if you want, type it right there, God is faithful. I say, type it there, God is faithful. Confess it. Say it with me right there, God is faithful. That's one thing that God, David, makes here. That's one thing that God, one truth that God, David, drives home as he made the contrast between the righteous and the wicked. David say, listen, God is faithful. Now, I want you to notice one thing as David is talking about. He looked back across the landscape of his life. He looked back at the landscape of his life, and David could see only one thing, the faithfulness of the Lord who always provide for his own. God is faithful and he always provide for his own. Beloved, you know, you need to understand one thing. These are not the word of a novice. Or it's not a word of an inexperienced young man that sit there maybe out of excitement and begin to write down certain things. No, these are the word of a godly experienced man. These are the word of a godly experienced man. A man that the Bible referred to as man after God's own heart. These are the words of David. David say, I have seen throughout my whole life. That's what he means by saying, I was young, now I'm old. So I'm not just speaking out of any kind of excitement. I am speaking out of experience. What I'm telling you right here are things that I've lived out throughout my life. It is not something I'm assuming. No, these are not assumptions, but these are truth which I'm certifying unto you, which I have seen throughout my whole life. Now, I want you to notice another thing right there. David is not just talking about himself. He does not say, I was young and now I am old. I have never seen a situation whereby God has forsaken me. No, he's not talking about himself only. He said, I have never seen the righteous. That means that is now globalizing, that now bringing all the children of God together right there. So what he's saying, saying, what I'm sharing with you right now, the truth that I'm bringing unto you are not just my own experience, but these are things that I have seen also in the life of every righteous man around me. Somebody say amen. Now I'm strengthened to hear and understand that God is faithful, not only to a certain category of the children of God, not only to some group of people that maybe give too much to the church or do whatsoever, but God is faithful to everyone that belong to Him. In Devon, I mean that is truly and sincerely, honestly belong to Him, those that are referred to here as a righteous man. David, beloved, has seen it all in his life. He has tested the bitter part of life. He has tested also the sweet part of life. He has experienced in his life both the pleasure and the pain. But now he brings unto us, he provides for us an expert testimony concerning the faithfulness of God. And we better listen to him because he's speaking out of experience under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. These are not just words that have been inspired unto him. But these are things that he has lived. These are the words, as I'm saying, of an expert testifying unto us about the faithfulness of God. When we look at the life of David, you will see that this is a man that has seen it all in his young age. In his young age, David, when taking care of the sheep, the flock of his father, there was a time whereby he has to fight against a lion. He has to fight against a bear. But God was still faithful. God was with him. When attacking a lion, God was with him. When attacking a bear, God was with him. God has never let him down in even difficult moment of his life. He has seen it all. There was a time in 1 Samuel chapter 16 whereby his own father has overlooked him. You can recall the time whereby the Samuel was sent to Jesse's house to anoint one of his son as king. The Bible says when Samuel got there, he asked Jesse to bring all his son. Jesse brought his son and they all passed before Samuel, say, and Samuel at the end of the day say, I have not seen the one that the Lord has chosen. Are all these your children? Even his own father has forgotten about him. And you will remember, oh no, I have another one somewhere there. He has seen it. He has seen also how he was, he suffered a hatred as well. In the hands of his brethren as well. You see 1 Samuel 17, where he went to bring about food to his brother. And he heard about the giant Goliath that was there threatening the entire nation. And as David went about inquiring about Goliath, his brother were against him. They were angry against him. They say, what have you come to do here? We knew that we were trying just to find an opportunity of joining us here. He has suffered all kind of things. He fought against the giant, the man of war, an experienced man of God. And there, God did not abandon him. Not only Goliath, you will agree with me that David, Goliath was not the only giant that David fought in his life. I'll recommend you to read and in 2 Samuel chapter 21, you will see another giant right there that David fought in his 50. In 2 Samuel chapter 21, the man by the name Ishbi-Benob, you see that David fought against this giant. David, he so many times, for such a very long period of his life, he was on the run as Saul was after his life. He was hiding in caves and here and there for his life. But in all those moments, God was faithful. God never forsake him. You understand? Right there. David also, there were a time, beloved, in 2 Samuel chapter 30, whereby his own men of war, they turn against him. They turned against him. They wanted to stone him. To make even matter worse, beloved, sometime in his life, in 2 Samuel chapter 15, his own son Absalom turned against him. He even chased him out of the kingdom of God. We can go on and pick up about experiences from his life. We can see also a moment in his life whereby God has has dealt with him severely. In the time whereby David has seen, when he has taken Bathsheba's Uriah's wife, and David murdered Uriah because he has impregnated his wife, and the Lord has dealt with him severely. Now, when David comes to the end of his life, he sits down, he looks back, he has seen the good and the bad experience. The moment where he walked in holiness, God was faithful unto him. Even when he has fallen into sin, I'm not trying to give you a license to sin right here, no. But even when he fell into sin, God was still faithful. Even when God was dealing with him because of his sin, judging him because of his sin, God was still faithful. When he was anointed as king, God was faithful. Even after being anointed as king, when Saul was coming out of after his life, God was still faithful. When sometime Absalom kicked them out, they went, even they were hungry, asking for food from this man Nabal, who has refused to give them food. God was still faithful. So he comes together, he says, "Beloved, I'm looking at my life right here. I've never seen a moment whereby God has abandoned me." David is not trying to say that his life did not have challenges. No. He's not saying that he's not faced difficulties in life. That is not what he's trying to say. But he's certifying unto us one thing. Irrespective of the time that you go through in your life, God remains faithful. Somebody say amen. Somebody agree with me and put it right there. God is a faithful, beloved. God will not change. There is a man of God who say, the work of God, let me quote his word, he say, "God's work done in God's will, in God's way, will never lack God's supply." I say, God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply. God's work done in God's way will never lack God's supply. What is he trying to say right there? Again, if we walk with God, if we do the work of God as he wants us to do, God will remain faithful and he will see to it that he may supply to our need. Whether you are a widow of Zarephath, God will supply to your need. If you are Israel going into the wilderness, God will give you manna. If you are Elijah and you've been sent to the brook of Cherith, God will send raven to feed you. When he stopped the season of the raven, God will raise a widow of Zarephath to do what? To feed you. Can you see? Well, from the wilderness or to anywhere you can go, God remain faithful. That's what David say. I've been young, now I'm old. Throughout my whole life, I have come to realize that God is faithful. Beloved, whether as I say you be Israel in the wilderness, or Elijah during the famine, or a widow without resources, God remain. If you remain obedient and dependent on the Lord, then the Lord is going to amaze you. He will supply to your need because he's a faithful God. Once again, I repeat, David is telling us one thing here. Beloved, the God in whom you believe is a faithful God. Do you feel abandoned right there? Let me tell you, you are not abandoned. God is faithful. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews chapter 10 verse 23 say, "Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." Somebody say amen. Hebrews 10:23, I read it again. He say, "Brethren, hold fast to the confession of your hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." Beloved, maybe right now you have begun to waver because of the situation. Doubt has begun bit by bit to settle in your heart. You have so much pressure, so much financial pressure, so much demand. The landlord is knocking on your door. The banks are sending emails. Hello, your rental agent. The bond is not yet paid. Your car's installments are not yet paid. And you see yourself being pressurized. There's no peace at home. You feel like you are being kind of, squeezed or whatsoever. Bible says, beloved, do not change the confession of your hope. Do not waver. Maintain that confession. He who told you that this is a year of a new beginning, let this pandemic not change your confession. Beloved, hold on unto the Lord, because he who made a promise is faithful. I believe it for myself. I believe it for my family, for my ministry, for those of you that are listening to me. He who made a promise, he is faithful. My eyes are not on the circumstances. My eyes are not on whatsoever. My eyes and my faith are on the Lord. And the Bible say, Hebrews say, hold on, let us hold fast unto the confession of our hope. Because he who made promise is faithful. David has experienced it. Beloved, you know, sometimes we are quick to say, the Lord has abandoned me. The Lord has forsaken me. I feel like left alone. Beloved, let me correct one thing right there. If we take in consideration 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 8, the Bible tells us this, listen, that we are to be sober-minded. We have to be watchful. Why? Because our adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking whom to devour. Now, the reason why you are alive today, even listening to me right now, it's because the Lord, the devil, has not devoured you. And you know why is it that the devil has not devoured you? Because God has been protecting you. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying right there. Because the devil is busy seeking whom to devour. Now, if you are not devoured, that means you are profiting, benefiting from some sort of protection somewhere. That protection is coming from God. So you cannot say God has abandoned you just because you are right now you're in a big mess and you don't see the way out. By the way, in any situation that God can allow you to go in, there is an exiting door. I want you to believe, even in your situation, there is a way out. Somebody say, there is a way out to my situation. There is a way out. You may not to see it. You just need to close your physical eyes. Go deep in your presence. Become watchful. Enter his presence and begin to see through the lenses of the word of God, through the guidance of the spirit of God. Begin to see what the heaven has in store for you, and begin now to download. Begin to download from heaven and change now the course of your life as the Lord will reveal unto you. I don't know if I'm talking to somebody right there. He is a faithful God. We are alive because he's faithful. You will go tonight to bed, maybe to sleep, because God is faithful. David said, beloved, I was young, now I'm old. Trust me, God is faithful. He does not abandon his own. He will not do it for you as well. Say again, God is faithful. Secondly, what God, David, is teaching unto us right there is showing us a second thing, that God always provides for the righteous. First of all, he's faithful. And in his faithfulness, God makes sure that he provides for the righteous. So we are learning from this Psalm 37 verse 25 that first, God is faithful. Secondly, God provides for the righteous. David says it, I was young and now I am old. I have never seen a righteous abandoned, not even his generation, his descended begging for bread. Why will they not beg for bread? Because God is there to supply to their needs according to his riches in Christ. David is not here, as I say, suggesting that when we serve God, we'll never face calamities. We'll never face trial or problem in our marriage. No, that's not what David is saying. Because as I say earlier on, David himself went through a difficult moment of life. He went to a moment whereby the Bible says they lack food, that they went to the table, even David and his men, they ate the bread from the table. And they said the show bread that was made for the priest, David and his men, they ate it because they did not have food. But mind you, get one thing, the fact that you ask for help one day does not make you a beggar. I don't know if I'm making sense right there. The fact that today I don't have money does not make me a broken man. It's just today that my pocket is empty. By the way, money's on the way. I don't know if somebody has my faith right there. It is just that I don't have it now, but I have it. It is somewhere, it is just coming. It does not make me a broken man. I'm broke, Pastor. I'm broke. No, it's just the situation right there. And he said, I have never seen God abandon a man for neglecting even his generation. He's not talking about, first of all, the righteous himself. He said, even his descendant. If his descendant cannot beg for bread, how much more the righteous man himself? I don't know if somebody's getting what I'm trying to say right there. God always provides. God always provides, beloved. As I said, David is not saying that I have never been hungry my entire life or needs food. No, he has seen that. He has experienced that in life. He's not saying I have never been in a situation whereby I needed help. No, right now, maybe you are in a situation where you might need some help from somebody or from a brother, from a sister, you may need some help from somewhere, but that does not mean God has abandoned you. No. That will be a wrong way of reading the word of God. That will be a wrong way of understanding God. The fact that maybe you are going through a dry season of your life, you're seeing manna falling here and there, but most of the things seem to remain dry, does not make you an abandoner, forsaken person. No, it is just a season. And in every season, God has a message for us. In every season, God has something, a purpose that you want to achieve. I don't know if I'm talking to somebody right there. In every season, there is something that God is expecting us to do. There is something that God is teaching us. He may allow a winter season to come because he wants to preserve us from certain things. The fact that you are going through difficult moment does not mean God has abandoned you. No. No, that will be wrong. I'm talking to you and say God has not abandoned you, but God is going to provide to your need according to his riches in Christ. David is saying the fact that you may go for a while through a difficult moment does not mean God has stopped providing for you. No, what David is saying here, I have never seen a moment where God did not take care of me. Even in your difficulties, beloved, you can see that God is still taking care of you. He's still taking care of you. God cannot go let you go. Listen to this. God cannot let you go to go through the entire wilderness without giving you manna or without giving you water from the rock. Aya, I don't know if I'm talking to somebody right there. It may feel like you are going through a wilderness, but watch out, there is manna. Watch out, there is a rock that is going to give you water. He will make sure that he provides at least for the necessity. Although the abundance is not overflowing here and there, but God will make sure manna will fall. God will make sure that you will have water. Oh, I don't know if somebody's getting with me. God will not stop taking care of you, beloved. We can count on the faithfulness of God because he says he's a faithful God. The fact that you're in the wilderness does not mean that God has abandoned you. No, you're on your way to Cana. I don't know if I'm talking to somebody. Wilderness means you are going to your Cana. So enjoy the manna for as long as it lasts. Because guess what? By the time you will step into your kind of manna will cease. I see somebody's manna ceasing right there in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Because the Bible says, as soon as Israel entered the land of promise, when they ate the first meal of the land, manna ceased. Somebody, what you are calling right now, God has forsaken you. Maybe it's just the cessation of manna. But the cessation of manna does not mean God has abandoned you. The cessation of manna means now I've brought you to a land that is going to produce much more than the manna that you've been enjoying in the wilderness. So what you do, don't get discouraged. Say, God, thank you, because manna has ceased. I will eat now from the land. The land will begin to produce in the mighty name of Jesus. Maybe, just maybe, this pandemic is marking for somebody the cessation of manna so that you may enter into the new land and start a new journey. Your new beginning is for sure. It is for sure. It is starting. I see the Lord saying it has been sealed before the foundation of the world and nothing is going to change it. God is ushering provision unto you. He saying, I know. Paul saying, I know my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in Christ. Let me close with this one. Yes. Let me close with this one right there. Finally, what we understand by this Psalm 37 verse 25, God always protects his own.
Firstly, we have discovered that God is faithful. And secondly, we have discovered that God always provides for the righteous. And thirdly, the evidence is testifying unto us that we can enjoy God's protection. He who has made promise is faithful. In the book of Hebrews chapter 13 verse 5, the Bible tells us that as he has promised, he will never leave us. He said, keep your life free from love of money and be content with what you have. For he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. The Lord will always protect us. He has done that in the life of David. He has been faithful from his youth until his old age. When he was nearing his death, God was still faithful. God kept on providing for this man, and God kept on protecting this man. Beloved, I want us, as we are closing, to just take a moment and thank God for his faithfulness and stop complaining. Stop complaining. You know, beloved, sometimes, I'm closing with these words. Sometimes for you, for us to realize the goodness, the faithfulness of God, we don't have necessary to look at our current situation, but we need to look back where we are coming from. That's why David has made his observation from his youth to his old age. You see, from the moment I was young until now that I'm old, I have noticed that God, I have not seen the righteous man forsaken, not even his generation, his descendant begging for bread. For the whole life, for the duration of his whole life, not only him, but the other righteous man of his time, they have experienced the same thing. And under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, David said, God is faithful. Throughout our life, he will remain faithful. Throughout our life, he will continue to protect us. Throughout our life, he will continue to provide for us. As I'm saying, in all thy time to see the goodness of God in your life, brother, it matters that you may look back. See how the Lord delivered you like David from the hand of the bear, and see the faithfulness of God during your warfare time. See how God protected you if you are a David when their soul was coming out of your life, after your life. When those witches of your family, of your surroundings are coming after you. When man, your colleague at work, they wanted you fire. They wanted you out at all costs. But the Lord was there to protect you. You see, when we start reflecting, looking back where we coming from, you will see the goodness of the Lord. You will see the faithfulness of the Lord. David looked at it. He analyzed it. He observed it from his youth until now, until he was about to die. And he said, God is faithful. Beloved, look back. Don't just look at the current situation. It might not look good. Your situation right now does not maybe inspire you hope. It does not inspire you hope at all. Every right from left to right, north to south to east to west, you don't see anything to hang on, but become like Habakkuk, who said, even though the crop, the my vine does not produce on whatsoever, there's nothing, but in you, the Lord of my salvation, I will rejoice because I know you are faithful. David said in Psalm 23 verse 4, though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because you are with me. Your rod and your staff are comforting me. Right now, maybe you are now experiencing, you are experiencing what we call the valley of the shadow of death experience, whereby death seemed to be too close to you. That marriage is just at the point of breaking up. That situation is about to die. The country, the world, everything seems to be collapsing. That the valley of the shadow of death experience, but the God say, Even though you go through that, I will be with you. When you go through waters, they will not submerge you. If you go through fire, they will not consume you. Guess what? Because he who made the promise to take you into that land, he is faithful. And he has all the necessary power to keep you until you reach your destiny. Beloved, I want you to declare with me, you are not the generation of those who died in the wilderness. No, you are not of a generation of those who die in the wilderness. We are of the generation of those that are going to see Cana and eat the fruit of Cana and bless the name of the Lord as we trying hard to remain obedient unto him, as we remain watchful and prayerful, as we continue to stand firm upon his word. Upon the word of promise, not looking at our current situation, not looking at those that are stoning us, not looking at the situation that are threatening us, but putting our eyes on the Lord. We are standing firm upon his word, and the Lord begins to show us his faithfulness. Through the valley of the shadow of death, his staff and his rod are there to comfort us. When we go through waters, he makes sure that they don't submerge us. He is there as our shepherd, that we may not want, because he is a faithful God. And I want to encourage somebody today, if you are walking in the fear of the Lord, remain the fear of the Lord. If you are not yet walking in the fear of the Lord, begin to walk in the fear of the Lord, because one thing we learn as well from this psalm is that the Lord as well take care of our descendant if we remain faithful unto him during our lifetime. That is one of the benefits that comes when we begin to serve the Lord. When we remain righteous unto him, we will not only eat the fruit of the land, but the descendant, those that will come after us as well, they will benefit of what we are doing right now with the Lord. I believe that my grandchildren will not die poor. They will not beg for bread. Why? Because the Lord who is my shepherd, the Lord whom I am serving, I'm serving today, the Lord to whom I've dedicated my life, he will see to it that I may not lack. He will see to it that my ministry may not lack. My children that I'm leading in the center of abundant grace may not lack. He will see to it that those who believe in him may not lack. He will see to it even our generation to come may not lack. Why? Because he's a faithful God that provides, that protects his own. I was young and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous man abandoned, forsaken, or even his children begging for bread. Beloved, take just a second. Thank God for his faithfulness. Stop complaining. Stop murmuring. Change your word. I don't see God. Pastor, I don't see God. I don't see what is going on in my life. I don't know what is going on in my life. Just look at the faithfulness of the Lord. Turn your house into a house of prayer, into a place of worship like Paul and Silas. Turn it to the place of worship. Don't look at the chains in your hand. Don't look at the difficulties. But look at the faithfulness of the Lord. And say, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your name. Give me with the right key. Oh, just say, take a minute. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. We are done. Just look at the faithfulness of the Lord for a few minutes. Let's bless the name of the Lord. Sing it. Hallelujah. Oh, my soul. Worship is all. Name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your name. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship. His holy name. From you, send us a comment, drop us an email, contact us on WhatsApp. Our numbers are there. We want to hear from you. If as well you want to support this work financially, you can do so by contacting us, and we'll let you know how to go ahead with that. For now, may the Lord bless you. Until we come again your way, stay well, stay blessed. If you're watching on YouTube and you are not yet a subscriber, please hit that subscribe button and that bell next to it so that you may be updated when we upload the next video. For now, we love you. We bless you. Stay safe and see you next time. God bless you. Bye-bye.